So my topic of presentation is damage control orthopedics and the role of external fixator in that. The term was applied basically for management of multiple injured patients, particularly the long bone fractures or a pelvic fractures, where fixators were basically used to control control the soft tissue injuries, control the bleeding, take care of the patient during that acute phase. The local damage control of these fractures with severe soft tissue injury provides a relative stability, and that helps in rapid stabilization of the fracture with minimal additional surgical injury. So the DCO, the damage control orthopedics, is consists of four phases, and out of that, what are important to us is the second phase and the fourth phase. The first phase is obviously a life-saving procedures are performed. The second phase in which we are involved, wherein we are temporarily stabilizing the major skeletal fractures or the pelvic fractures. And then after patient is monitorized in the ICU, then we are again involved in the fourth phase, which involves definitive fracture fixation. So the acute fracture care basically consists of two categories, that is a provisional or definitive. Provisional fixation is further subdivided into damage control and taking care of the periarticular fractures, particularly wherein there is a lot of edema. We need a window period for the soft tissue to stabilize. If there are obvious blebs, we have to wait for a certain period. Or patients who are not fit for major surgeries can be skeletally stabilized by the fixator. It can also be used as a definitive fixator. However, its role is very limited today. Historically, it has gone through six generations. The first generation were basically very classic unilateral frames. The second generation were uniplanar frames subjected to cantilever bending biplanar with improved biomechanical properties, and that is what most commonly we are using today. The third generation was in 1950s, where Elizarov came in picture. The fourth generation is where we are using articulated external fixator, which allow hinges, and that is how you can carry out movements of the joint. The fifth generation is a hexapod. Probably Mangal and Dr. Chaudhary will speak a lot about it. And the sixth generation is a hybrid, wherein you use a combination of a ring fixator and uniplanar or a biplanar fixator, particularly for periarticular fractures like tibial condyle or lower end of the tibia, which involves fixation of the metaphysis with the help of a ring. Because of its strategic location, we have to use a circular fixator, a single ring in this particular areas. So the components are basically the pins, the clamps, and the connecting rods. The pins, it is a critical link between the bone and the frame, and thicker the pin, larger its stiffness, and that helps in stabilizing or giving a good construct to the frame. So a rule which should be followed is it should be less than 1/3. So that means you must use 5 mm pin in humerus, femur, and tibia, and 3 or 4 mm in radius and ulna. So that is a principle wherein your pin diameter should be 1/3 of the circumference of the bone. The pins, they come in various diameter, lengths, and design, like a 2.5 millimeter or a 4 mm short threaded pin or a 5 mm pre-drilled pin, a 6 mm tapered or a conical tip pin, or a 5 mm self-drilling or self-tapping pin, or we have pins which have central threads, particularly used in particular fixators, and they can be of various material like steel or a titanium. Titanium is more less stiff and more biocompatible. the pins recently have been coated with antibiotics, chlorhexidine, silver, and hydroxyapatite. And the literature suggests that the hydroxyapatite coated pins, particularly used in osteoporotic and elderly, have a better fixation as compared to the non, where the, these coatings are not used. And so also the infection rate in these types of pin is very less. Most common complication is a pin tract infection, and for that, how you insert the pin is the most important, wherein you must take liberal incisions. Don't compromise on taking a small incisions with a pin tract. You must open out the soft tissues. Use a sharp drill. The blunt drills will generate more heat, will produce more soft tissue and bone necrosis, subsequently will lead to loosening of the pin tract. And while you're drilling, particularly if your drills are older, you must irrigate with cold saline so that you reduce the thermal necrosis. And place the pin while using the drill, while using the tap, while using the pins, you must use a trocar all the time to avoid the soft tissue damage and the thermal necrosis. Things are not clear whether you should use a power or a hand to pass these pins. However, it is suggested, or what is available in the theory, the literature suggests if you're using a hand to insert this pin, you are generating more temperature rather than the power instruments. The self-drilling pins, they have a peculiar problem that when you are drilling the near cortex, it strips the near cortex, and when you are reaching the far cortex, particularly when you're using the power, it strips the near cortex, thereby loosening the pin hold in the near cortex. So these are not recommended, particularly when you're using in a osteoporotic or in the diaphysis, because the wobble factor may give rise to the wobble which occurs at the near cortex may give rise to necrosis. The pin diameter, as already I have pointed out, femur, tibia, and humerus, usually 5 millimeter is required, and forearm, hand, foot, it is 3 millimeter or a 4 millimeter pin must be used. The clamps, they come in two general varieties, wherein we can attach a single pin to the bar, or you can use multiple pin to the bar. The features of multiple pin which can be attached to the bar is you can adjust, and they come in various shapes. Either you can use it as an open or a closed way. The principle is it must be securely holding the frame to the pin, and clamps which are placed closer to the bone increase the stiffness of the entire fixator construct. The connecting rods or the frames, we have an option in the material and in the design. And the principle is increase the diameter, increases the stiffness and the strength. A stacked or a two parallel bar increases the overall stiffness of the frame. The frame times again, which is most important when you are planning the construct stability, or you should know how long you are want to continue the frame. If it is for a short time or if it is for the long time. The uniplanar or a biplanar, particularly the pin transfixes the extremity, and in biplanar we have a unilateral or a bilateral frame, or we have a circular fixator frames or a hybrid type which we have discussed earlier. The standard frame is we have pin which are closer to the fracture and then far away where the pins are spread to the metaphysis at the ends of the bone. So this is a stable construct, but the situation changes if we have a gap or if we have a bone loss or if there is a comminution in the diaphysis. The joint spanning frame, the indications are particularly when there is a comminution in the metaphysis or intraarticular or a periarticular fractures. It can be used as a definitive fixation through a ligamentous texis, wherein the wrist particularly, I think Rajesh is going to speak on that, or you can use it as a temporary fixator, wherein we can combine by adding particularly in the long oblique or a short oblique metafacial fracture, where you can, or intra-articular fracture, where you can combine the internal fixation like a lag screws for oblique fractures or intra-articular fractures, and then spanning the joint across. It can also be used as a damage control in severe vascular and ligamentous injury. So one such example is this type of fracture, where the patient has a soft tissue injury, a swelling, wherein a fixator is used to reduce the dislocated ankle and to realign the intra-articular fracture and the peri-articular fracture, and that helps in reducing the soft tissue swelling and taking control in acute injury. Articulated frames, they allow, with the help of a hinges, a joint motion in a situation where the joint is unstable and you cannot reconstruct or repair the ligaments. And the care is you must adjust the hinges at the precise axis of the joint motion. So that means particularly when you're using at the elbow, you have to be very particular when you are using that for instability of the elbow, where your hinge, the center of rotation should be, the hinge should be at the level of the center of rotation. The frame, they provide stability, or the stability can be improved if you increase the pin diameter. Like if it is a 5 or 6 mm, the stability of the frame is better. If you have increased pin spread, that means the distance of this pin, the first and the second pin, if it is more in this particular type of fracture, it increases considerable stability to the frame. If you increase the number of pin, it also increases the stability. The decreased distance from the pin to the frame, if you reduce the distance between the pin and the frame, that also adds to the stability of the frame. So care must be taken when you are particularly using the frame, when there is a diaphysis, where is a displacement, where there is a comminution, where there is a loss. You must not use this type of frame where you have reduced the pin spread and your pins are far away from the fracture, or your rod is quite away from the fracture. So that will lead to a situation like this, where your fracture stability will be compromised. So minimizing the cantilever effect, the bending and the shear of the fracture will be considered if you add stability to the frame by the ways what we have discussed. Decreasing the distance of the rod from the bone increases the stability of the frame. Double stacking or using two rods also adds up stability to the frame. The construct can be used in various modes, like a compression when there is a transverse fracture, or neutralization when there is a oblique or oblique fracture, or you can use it in a distraction mode in a situation where there is a bone loss. You can manipulate the fixator stability. You can increase the stability by increasing the diameter of the pins, increasing the number of the pins, increasing the pin spread, the number of plane pins are placed, or the diameter of the rod, if you increase, it will increase the stability of the frame. Similarly, you can decrease the stability or the construct by decreasing the distance, that is the pin to fracture distance. If it is increased, you reduce the stability. If you increase the distance between the rod and the bone, it decreases the stability. So you can play according to the fracture, according to the location, whether it is in the diaphysis, metaphysis, and give a good construct to an individual fracture. These complications, pin track loosening, frame or pin wire failure, or a malunion or a non-union, we are not using that as a definitive mode. So these two things are not to be considered. The overall incidence of pin track infection is 14%, and they are in four stages: where superficial, where there is a only seropilurant discharge, or there is a superficial cellulitis. So these two, stage one and two, can be taken care with antibiotics and proper dressing. Three and four, where the infection is deep, requires changing of the pin and IV parenteral antibiotics. The most important is, which we have seen, how you insert the pin, and the other is prevention, where you can keep the pins away from the zone of the injury or the contamination. You must take adequate skin incision, use cannulae, use a sharp drill, and manual pin insertion would reduce higher incidence of pin track infection. The radial preload, wherein you are drilling the near cortex with slightly smaller core diameter than of the pin, will reduce in significantly in loosening the pin. Compartment syndrome is very rare. Whenever you are converting the fixator to an internal fixation, there are a lot of factors which you must consider. The safe period is anyway between 10 days to about 3 weeks. It should be used in caution when there is a sign of pin tract irritation, like there is a serous discharge or the skin around the pin is not good. In those situations, you must consider an interval at least of 2 weeks where you allow the pin tract to heal, and then you should go for a definitive fixation. If there is a full-blown discharge, you must remove and curate the sites and then allow or give a holiday period, pin holiday period of about 10 days, and then you can return for your definitive fixation. The other factors which you must consider is the extent of internal injury, the soft tissue injury, the stability of the fixator, the physiological state of the patient whenever you are considering converting a fixator to a definitive mode. And to conclude, the construct tips are: choose an optimal pin diameter as per the bone, whether it is femur, humerus, tibia, or foot, hand, or the forearm. Use a good insertion technique, which we have discussed. Place the clamps and the frame close to the skin, the frame in the plane of a deforming force. Stack the frame if there is a instability, and it has multiple application. You must choose the component and the geometry which is suitable for a particular application, whether it is in the metaphysis, diaphysis, whether it is tibia or femur. Appropriate use can lead to an excellent result. Recognize and correct the complications early. Thank you.
So any questions? One thing I want to start off with, Sangeet, you showed pictures, all the pictures which you showed were mainly or only, I think, of the AO kind of external fixator. I remember when I was a resident, and even today I see often what's known as an SQLAP type of fixator, where there are smaller bars and one nut will loosen the pin as well as the bar. Rod. So what do you think about that kind of fixator? Do you think it's a good idea, not a good idea? Why?
But we don't have choice. Those older, like what have been described here, they are not available where you have a separate fixation for the pin or for the connecting rod. So
this one is available. What you showed is available. So how many, you know what I'm talking about? The SQLAP with a round clamp. How many of you all use that? Yeah. So I think there is one big issue there, because those rods are thinner. The pins that those clamps accept is usually 4.5. I don't think they normally accept a 5mm pin.
There are smaller ones available which you use for the forearm.
Forearm is fine. Forearm is fine. But so what you mean cannot apply the principles that he was talking about.
So you mean to say they are only for forearm or hand or foot? They are not meant for femur humerus tibia because they don't take 6 mm or thicker 5 mm pin, which
that's
is
one.
Required. Secondly, the size of the rod is very compromised, which is again thin.
Compared to, I think the AO one is 11 mm and this one is probably 8 mm if I'm not mistaken. So that immediately cuts down with your stability. And that may be one of the reasons why fixators, even in the early, you know, provisional care, not even definitive care, you're going to be talking of definitive use, right? So what do you use?
More commonly the Asculap one, and we get those 6x8 clamps. So routine clamps are actually 4 or 4.5 pins they are accepted. If you are using a taper pin, then we need a 6x8 clamps.
Correct.
So you need to go get those clamps.
So you don't use the shit which the dealer gives you.
No.
You demand a particular thing based on the principles what he was talking about. Right. And what about these, you have a described, you know, rod-to-rod clamp. That is, you fix the proximal fragment separately, distal fragment separately, and then manipulate between the two with a rod-to-rod clamp. How useful or... because you have to have perfect reduction and then put the fixator on.
That is, the question is when you are adjusting across the joint. But again, the concept is only here we are using for a temporary phase, wherein you cover the soft tissue or the acute phase is over and then you go for switch over after a holiday period for a definitive fixation.
So it's kind of okay.
Probably you would be using more because you are considering a definitive fixation or you are adding a hinge to that for mobility of the joints.
Yeah, but we are in private. Pradeep is in a public hospital. And oftentimes, I think it may take a lot of time for the patient to come up for definitive surgery. What do you think in terms of what fixator you use?
Generally, I use a Asculap fixator I use it for the ease of applicability. Because if you see the AO fixator clamps and the Asculap fixator, the Asculap fixator clamp can be dissociated into all components altogether. Whereas AO, the rod has to be, the clamp has to be mounted on the rod first and then the pin needs to be passed. So adding a pin to an existing fixator frame becomes extremely difficult with AO type of fixator. However, with Asculap, we can add an N amount of pins to the existing frame. And so that is very versatile feature of versatile.
But that is too
many.
So that can, I think, can be used. Yeah, 4.5. We use 4.5 pins.
While going through the literature, I'm still confused whether you should use a hand drill or a power drill for inserting the pin after having pre-drill. Any take on that?
Milin?
When I started working at Jaslok, everybody was using a power drill. But I find that you can vary the torque. And I'm not sure.
No, the heat generated by hand is much more as compared to the power. And there are other reports, other literature support where they talk exactly opposite.
I belong to the opposite camp.
So you use hand?
Hand insertion.
And drilling?
Yeah, pre-drill. And sometimes...
So drilling is with power?
Power.
Drilling is with power.
Insertion is by hand?
Is by
both
hand.
Both for wires and screws?
Yes, of course. And sometimes we under-drill. We choose to under-drill.
What does that mean, under-drill?
That's, you know... Even though we are using a 5-4 taper half pin, we'll use sometimes
Smaller diameter. So what he was talking of radial preload. Great. So you have any thoughts?
I don't know. It came a little late. Did you talk about the rod-to-rod clamps? You know why? Because when you don't use the rod-to-rod clamps and you put two pins in the upper fragment, lower. I'm talking about tibia, and you require that parallel bar. To put it exactly, right? You remember that there is to be a parallel bar so that...
Can you take your mic away? Can you take your mic little away? Yeah.
You require a parallel bar to see that all four pins are in order to hold it in proper. Whereas a rod-to-rod clamp is an advantage where you can put in any plane and then later on finally you can adjust. So that's an advantage for rod-to-rod. So we use small rods for a proximal fragment, small rods for a distal fragment, use rod to rod clamp, and then finally, when you are finished with whatever your soft tissue debridement and all that, then you can finally fix it. So there is definitely an advantage for rod to rod clamp.
See that particular issue would come if you are using as a definitive for a definitive situation. Now, it really doesn't make a difference whether there is a slight displacement or slight rotation because your fixator is temporary. Second, it adds up to the cost, and again, the frame becomes bulky if your plastic surgeon friend is involved in that when he is considering skin cover or a flap. So that adds up to the bulk of the fixator, adding a rod between the two.
Right. So, meaning there is a science, and I think the bottom line is a lot of us at the moment are not following the science. Why? So if we are having trouble with fixators, there are two, three things we need to look at. Are we using the right size? Are we using the right configuration in terms of near and far, especially if you are in a situation where the fixator is going to be prolonged for a little while. If it's going to be in 5 days and 7 days, you know, if you are in the private sector like him and me, then you get the patient to theater. But in teaching institutions or in public hospitals, that may not always be the case. Thank you, Sangeet.